Thank you, Teddy. Thank you, Samuel. So yes, over to me now to introduce our final speaker of the day, of the entire programme actually. So 2 days have gone really, really quickly, and I'm hopeful that you've all enjoyed yourselves. So our final speaker of the day is someone called Sophie Leake. She's a CIOB Rising Star Award. The International Rising Star Award celebrates new exceptional talent in the industry. It awards individuals who have demonstrated the highest level of excellence at every stage of their career in construction. Sophie is a site manager at Speller Metcalfe, one of the UK's leading regional contractors. She has taken a non-conventional approach to the construction industry and is keen to share her journey and lessons learned over the last 10 years, creating further awareness of a variety of ways into construction, and the opportunities are open to anyone willing to work for them. As well as being a key member of projects she works on, she's also a CIOB Tomorrow's Leaders member, a chartered MCIOB mentor here at the CIOB. She's part of the Hereford and Worcestershire Construction Excellence Committee, a member of the National Federation of Builders. She's an ambassador for them. In 2022, she took home the Midlands G4C Future Leader Award and also made it to the top 100 influential women in construction. It's really amazing, Sophie. So without further delay, I'd like to invite Sophie to the stage on her talk on finding your place in construction. Over to you, Sophie. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm not quite sure how I'm going to follow that introduction, if I'm honest. hello to everyone. As mentioned, my name is Sophie. Day to day, I am a site manager for Speller Metcalfe. And as you heard, I do quite a bit on the side as well. What I'm hoping to do for you guys in this presentation is to kind of inspire you a little bit, as well as demonstrating a possibly non-conventional route within construction, and as the title suggests, how I've managed to find my place in construction, and how you guys would be able to as well. A little bit kind of about me. I kind of started within construction 4 years ago now within Speller Metcalfe, but I've always kind of been within the industry. Mainly starting, I went down to Bournemouth for my degree and did industrial design, which I don't actually think exists anymore, which is a bit sad. But I didn't actually think that I was going to go to university. I thought I was done with academics. I thought that I really wanted to kind of get out there and do my bit. Went on an open day, as Samuel mentioned in the last talk, and completely fell in love with not just Bournemouth, but that particular course. So I think that in the journey that I've had, I've always tried to think of just that next one step on what kind of aligned with what I wanted to do at the time. I then did my placement within commercial interior design for a company down in Portsmouth, completing over 70 projects in 1 year, which is indeed excessive. then went back to them after I completed my dissertation, which happened to be on timber construction. And you'll see the irony of that when I start to discuss my projects a little bit within Speller's. So after that, I decided to come back up to the Midlands, and I became a fit out and furniture project manager. I was hired as an interior designer and worked my way through into that project management role. I'm not very good at sitting still at all. I pretty much always say yes to everything. I grew into that project management role. I work really well with placement students and things. I really strongly agree with kind of placements within degrees and things to get that application to learning, I think, is really important. And any kind of courses that have kind of external lecturers or kind of live projects and that type of thing, so that students can get that application, is really kind of crucial coming out the other end of your degrees and masters and that type of thing. I then kind of had a little bit of a reflection moment. I'm quite an impulsive person, and sat down with my boss at the time on a normal Tuesday, I think it was, and started to discuss kind of where things were going and what I wanted to achieve. And at the time, they kind of said, we need you to be the interior designer that you always were hired to be. So I decided at that point to hand my notice in and very amicably kind of parted ways because my kind of journey was heading elsewhere. I then reached out to Speller Metcalfe, who are a very local company to where I live. And in doing a little bit of research, they are a very kind of socially forward company. It's not just about meeting statistics and things. So for me personally, it aligned really well with all of the kind of extra bits that I felt like I could give to a project. Developing from a assistant design coordinator into a project coordinator through a few kind of additional bits that I'll discuss in a little bit. And then deciding that I really did want to go into operations and have been a site manager now for the past 2 years to get that kind of hands-on experience on site. So what would I kind of pass on to someone coming into the industry? First of all, as part of your little kind of toolkit, is to really create an awareness of the team that you sit in. And if you're able to bridge gaps, whether it's between a design team or whether you're on site or wherever it is, that picture there is the architects on the last job there. And if you're able to appreciate somebody else's role, you don't necessarily have to kind of see eye to eye with them all the time. That's not necessarily a bad thing. It's good to challenge each other. As long as you have that kind of mutual respect, then actually pulling together as a team and really appreciating what somebody else is bringing to the table. You might be asking for them that something for them that takes a really long time to do and you don't realize it. Whereas if you just have that awareness of your team and then also how you can kind of bolster yourself to be more valuable within the teams that you're in. So I have trained within sustainability. I am a BREEAM AP, along with I'm really keen on kind of developing soft skills as well. So really thinking about whether that is kind of your report writing, maybe it is presenting, being client facing, or even down to I've worked with quite a lot of placement students or kind of graduates coming into the industry, that the idea of making a phone call, it is quite scary when you don't know the person at the end of the phone. And if it's just you're slowly kind of chipping away at those skills as well, that coming out of the end of the course that you're doing will all make you a more desirable candidate when you come to kind of come out into the industry. So it's kind of one of those phrases that comes up a lot, but you really do get out what you put in. So whether that is surrounding yourself with the people that you aspire to be, whether it is kind of developing yourself a group of mentors that each one of them has a quality that you would like to develop into, then it's all kind of working towards that person that you would like to be kind of in the future, and making sure that when these people are giving you time that you're using it appropriately as well. So I had I do quite a lot of site visits, walking around the sites and things, and I've hosted kind of hundreds of students really, but it's probably only maybe 10% of students that actually engage with me when we're out on site. So when I get emails from the academics or lecturers that are a kind of a follow-up on this person would like help with their dissertation, or could I pass on your details because they want to ask more questions about whatever it is, I'm much more inclined to give you my time on helping with your dissertation or whatever it is. If you've engaged with me when you've come out to see me, I've had experiences where I've had students just kind of sitting there on their phones and things when they've come out onto site, and I've kind of given my time, and we've prepped the site and that type of thing. So really thinking about when you do get in a room with these professionals, that really see it as an opportunity and kind of making the most of that experience, and really taking responsibility for your own development, because no one will put you higher up on your list than you do. So if you do get into a situation where you're in a development review or you're in a kind of mentoring situation, what do you really want to kind of get out of these experiences, and kind of whether it is researching a particular area that you would like to develop, or you would like to, it might be a top-up course, it might be a whatever it is, but kind of doing all of the work first so that you're asking for help on your own idea rather than relying on someone else to tell you where you should be going. I mean, I've got a list there of the bits and pieces that I've got involved in since kind of being within Speller Metcalfe. And it can be as little as kind of helping out with the marketing team. If you're already hosting a visit or that type of thing, just grabbing a photo and sending it across to them can help them out an awful lot. And then you've already done the hard work of hosting the visit in the first place. So definitely how you can help out others is a really great skill as well as when you then need support, they're much more willing to help you. And then as a kind of last thought really is that who you are doesn't define you. There's a lot of stories that kind of anyone I'm sure can tell of how a particular teacher told you that you couldn't do something, so you wanted to prove them wrong, that there was perhaps a family member that said you wouldn't be able to do something. And that's a great starting point, but you really shouldn't leave that as the only reason that you're doing something. You really need to own it, and kind of your journey to be your own, and to kind of be proud of who you are. Obviously I'm quite I'll say different, being a female site manager. It's not something that is the norm at the moment, but I mean, I don't expect any kind of special circumstance for that. I don't want to be known as a good female site manager. I just want to be a good site manager. So definitely trying to own who you are will definitely help you when you are sitting in front of whether it's potential employers or your new design team or wherever you end up. Knowing who you are and the strengths that you have will really help you, along with having really tangible goals that you work towards, whether it is your MCIOB or working on the soft skills that I mentioned and that type of thing. But really putting in the work and doing things kind of for yourself and seeing your own value and developing your own value, you will get noticed. And it still seems almost daft to me on the awards that I was very fortunate to receive last year, that I've never worked towards an award. I've never seen that as a goal. but it was more, they're seen as recognition pieces. It is kind of on achievements that are kind of in the past. So in terms of kind of, I suppose, advice moving forward, it would be that if you do put in that time and the effort and you believe in yourself, that just like the CIOB kind of rising star award, you do get there and people do see it. And whether it is on that bigger platform or it might be that your boss recognizes the effort that you've been put in, or you are the one that is putting yourself forward for an opportunity. If you can evidence that you've put in the work, then people will notice. So what I've got now is just a few of the projects that I've been working on. So this one in particular is the one I've just come off. It is the new Hereford University and is called NMITE. It is a CLT structure, CLT construction on the front of it. And then we've got two workshops that were in steel frame off the back of it. It is a really lovely building, and it had a really nice kind of design team with it. We all really pulled together as the project team and the wider team as well. And that's what I really mean about knowing and respecting people's skill sets, in that not any one person can know everything, but if you all pull together, then you can deliver a project based on lessons learned or years of experience or whatever it might be. Every project needs, what do they say? To raise a child, it takes a village. I think you could probably say the same about a building, that it takes a village to build a building. Because if it didn't have the client, it didn't have their funders and their supporters, and you didn't have a structural engineer, or you didn't have an environmental manager, or you didn't have a construction manager, or whatever the role is, it needs everyone. And then you get results like the one we've got on the screen there. And there's some just interior shots and things. You can see there's quite a lot of exposed timber there. As I mentioned, there's an awful lot of lessons learned and things when you're working with a finishing product that is actually holding the building up. Prior to that, I was on a scheme that was another CLT. This is actually a completely CLT cross-laminated timber building. It's three stories. This was for the University of Wolverhampton and Hereford Council. It's the new Midlands Cyber Quarter. Again, it was out in Hereford. And you can see there, these are where the lessons learnt come from, in that on the project that I've just completed, I was a relatively kind of junior member of the team, but I just worked on a timber project. So at the point that we needed to get our Class O on and all of these things on kind of moisture content and that type of thing come into play, being able to sit kind of side by side with my colleagues and say, off the back of the last project, this is what we need to implement, and being listened to as well, and being part of teams that you do listen to each other. And as I said, that mutual respect really does come into play when you're out on site and trying to deliver something like this. So I'm going to end there. I'll see if there's any questions.
Thank you, Sophie. Thanks for that. We'll wait for some questions. We haven't had any come through yet. But I've got a question that I'd like to ask of you, if that's all right. Mm-hmm. You talk a lot about your career today and the path that you've taken, which is amazing. As a site manager, it's about teamwork, and you've talked about a little bit about that. It'd be interesting to kind of, from your point of view, sum up, what are those key ingredients to an effective team or having the best team, in your opinion?
Having a sense of humour helps, I think, to start with. I think that you have to get to a point that you 100% trust your team and rely on them, because it will get to a point that you are opening up the site at 7 o'clock in the morning, in the dark, in the winter, in the pouring rain, and the only thing going through your head is, why the hell am I doing this? And it's your team that get you through. And I think that knowing everybody's strengths and weaknesses, and knowing where you stand with them, is always paramount. And it's something that I know Samuel touched on in his last talk, but I think having diversity within your team is really important as well. And not just, I don't just mean that from kind of a gender cultural kind of way, but also in skill sets as well. So like I was saying, I was pulled across from my last project being in timber construction and put onto that next project so I could bring all of that across. So it is having that diversity. You might have a particular team member who is great with technology, but is fairly new to construction. Or you might have a kind of more senior member of the team who kind of doesn't know how to use their mobile phone and kind of needs, but has been in the industry for kind of decades. So have a huge amount of kind of hands-on experience. So finding the perfect kind of mix of people that all kind of work together, I think is really critical, because if everybody was exactly the same, then you wouldn't have a very effective team, because you might as well just do it yourself. Because if you already know the answer that someone else is going to give, then it's not a different perspective, is it? So yeah, having differences in opinion, differences in skill set, differences in perspective because of background, and then obviously like gender and culture come into that as well, are all really great ways of creating a really successful team.
Brilliant, thank you so much. That's really a rounded response, actually. Sticking to diversity, it was International Women's Day yesterday. Mm-hmm. So from your perspective, I know you said you don't want to be known as the woman site manager, just the site manager, which is great. I think that's great. Gender shouldn't define you. But do you think the sector's doing or has moved forward in terms of catering for females now much better than before?
I really strongly believe that there's two halves to that answer. And as you can imagine, I get asked it quite a lot. I think that the first half of it is getting better within kind of educating an awareness of what is out there, whether it is through kind of your schools fairs and your placements, or giving kind of students the awareness of the variety of roles that are out on site. I know that kind of quantity surveying and construction management seem to be fairly kind of popular courses at the moment, but there are so many roles within construction, and I think that it's unrealistic to expect that academics or teachers, say even down to kind of primary schools and things, that they would know about all of these roles. They've got a job to do themselves. How on earth could they cover all industries knowing all roles? So I really think it's the responsibility of your industry, whether it is construction or, I don't know, accounting, whatever it is, to go back and to take responsibility of showcasing your industry. I think the second part to that answer is, I think that the diversity will come off the back of all of the effort that is being put into kind of schools and that type of thing, all of the site visits and working with kind of university, having, as I said, the live client briefs and that type of thing. It will come. It might take some time, but I think that also as an industry, we need to be ready for when it does. So just speaking more from kind of obviously a female kind of perspective, if you get an influx in females and then you're kind of surprised by it, then the joke's on you, really, whether that be kind of what they need to be supported when they are in that role, whether that is kind of female fit PPE, which is, I tell you, horrendous, or I don't know, having obviously like sites and things, making sure you have the correct kind of toilet facilities and that type of thing. There's a drive at the moment within considerate constructors to make sure that you've got kind of appropriate kind of feminine hygiene like products, and you have to have sanitary bins and that type of thing. So that's now part of their mark scheme when they go and see these sites. They are like, it is now an expectation to be supporting, whether it is kind of disabled access or that type of thing. So I think that it is definitely keeping up the momentum of awareness of what's available, but then also prepping for what's coming.
Brilliant. Thank you. Thank you for those responses. We've come to the end of the speaking session now. And in fact, we've come to the end of the CIOB Student Festival. So thank you so much for being our great speaker, and especially the last one that we're ending with as well, Sophie. So you've been brilliant. So thank you so much. And hopefully we'll work together a bit more in the near future as well. Thank you.